Mr. Casey is a NASA veteran, an engineer, familiar with things like missiles. He's not going to talk about NASA and the space program and the shutdown of the shuttle program.
Thanks, Obama.
Yes, thanks, Mr. Obama. But he does have a background in the high technology industries for over 35 years. He was also a White House research consultant. He is currently the president of the Space and Science Research Corporation in Orlando, Florida. They do science and planning for the next climate change. Now, Al Gore was very upset with the people like you hobbits out there, who don't believe him when he talks to his friends at the Aspen Institute about global warming. Well, Mr. Casey has a book that's on sale in the back of the room. It is called Cold Sun. While Mr. Gore and his cronies and the people who are pushing these agendas to take away your property rights and even the rights of where you live, how you educate your children, Mr. Casey says, instead of worrying about how hot it is, my daughter lives in Texas and she's complaining about 10 straight days of 100 degree heat. Well, pretty soon she's going to be complaining about the snow. At least that's what Mr. Casey wants to warn us about. And they had an interesting show about volcanoes and earthquakes on, I don't know which channel that was, maybe the Discovery Channel. But you might want to pick up a copy of the book called Cold Sun by John L. Casey. So, John, I'm going to let you explain what your book is all about and what your concerns are about where the climate is going. Mr. John Casey, ladies and gentlemen.
As they say, this is not rocket science. My name is John Casey. I'm the head of the Space and Science Research Corporation out of Orlando. The SSRC, to keep the name short, is a loose association of like-minded scientists around the world who have been stepping up to the plate and trying to tell their respective governments and people that what we have been told for decades about the Earth's climate is wrong, that we have been deceived, that we have been misled, and it was intentional. This is no accident. I think at this point you've already had two very experienced people get up and speak. Ruth Esser, who has done an outstanding job trying to put this program together, and she certainly knows her stuff when it comes to Agenda 21 and what it all means. And we are so honored to have Dr. Michael Kaufman get up today and speak. He is truly one of the gifted people in this country, and he certainly is passionate about making sure we stop this overall program that's coming our way. Let me get to the core issue in this presentation. We're going to talk about climate change and how the UN is influencing our lives and our government on climate change. But let me say that specifically, climate change has become the tool by which governments, the UN, other foreign governments, and our own government is trying to change our lives and take control of our lives. And today we're going to talk about some of the myths of climate change, how this all got started, and then we're going to talk about the reality, what's really happening with the climate, the truth of the story, or as the late Paul Hardy would say, now you're about to hear the rest of the story when it comes to climate change. What we're going to try to do is wrap this up in a short period of time, and I want to give as much time as possible to question and answer, so I'm going to go very quickly through this, but basically we're going to show you that climate change is not what you've been told. First and foremost, global warming does not exist. Thank you. We know, and scientists around the world have known for years, that global warming has ended and ended years ago. We also know that our government has been telling us the false story that not only is global warming still continuing, but that it's going to have terrible consequences in the future. And of course, we're all familiar with Al Gore's Inconvenient Truth and lots of other stories that have come out. We'll expose some of those myths with real hard facts. I will show you conclusively when global warming ended and what our future will be, and that's the gist of our presentation today. Furthermore, in item 4 on this chart, you'll see there's a lot more that you need to be told about the reality of climate change. We are facing 40 years of dangerous cold weather. Unfortunately, after 20 years of global warming propaganda, we now have a country that is totally unprepared for what is really happening with our climate. And we'll get into the details of that. Unbeknownst to Al Gore and the rest of the global warming movement, this is really the source of climate change. It is the sun, not man, that changes climate. The sun is the most powerful natural source in our solar system, but somehow mankind's ego has exceeded that power in the last 20 years. Unfortunately, we're dealing with the results of that politically, regulation-wise, tax-wise, and hopefully with people like you standing up and saying, enough's enough, we can end this charade. I have been trying to do this for 4 years now, since I initially discovered the solar cycles that determine climate, or at least most of the climate we have to deal with. Arthur Schopenhauer, many years ago, said that people like me who present new ideas go through several stages of acceptance. First of all, we're rejected, ridiculed, sometimes violently opposed, and then ultimately everyone says, gosh, we knew this all along. Well, hopefully we'll get to that phase this year. I believe now is the time. Uh-oh, how did this guy get in there? You want me to go back? No. A little about my background. I have been probably one of the more fortunate people on this planet. I have been exposed to some of the best and brightest scientists in the world, some of whom have joined with me at my SSRC, the Space and Science Research Corporation. But a little about my background. I have been asked to come to the White House a number of times to give advice on our space program. This goes back a ways. Some of you who have as much gray hair as I do can relate to George H.W. Bush when he was in the White House. Operating under General Colin Powell, I chaired a National Space Policy Committee in 86 and 87. President H.W. Bush ultimately used much of the results of our commission to draft his own space policy. I have been back and forth to Washington many, many times. The last work I did for the White House was a classified program in 2007. I am not welcome in the Obama White House. I need your help to vote in a conservative president who wants to tell the truth so I can get back to the White House and do my job again. I have been advisor to Congress, primarily to Chairman of the House of Representatives, Science Committee chairs. I've been a headquarters, NASA headquarters consultant. I chaired an internal NASA committee to examine the quality and safety failures that led to the Challenger accident as a result of the changes we implemented. The Challenger and the space program stayed safe for 17 years. Until the Space Shuttle Columbia accident, which of course also did not need to happen. And of course, I love high tech. I love creating jobs. The tougher the technology, that's where I want to be. And I've created a number of jobs and a number of companies over the years. I'm very proud of that contribution. We do have question and answer time set aside at the end. But if at any time you feel motivated and you've got to get a question out, please feel free. I am wide open to talking with you anytime on these slides. I do have a book that's come out. We are providing that book in the back of the auditorium. This book, however, is not the reason I'm here, other than it is simply another tool that I'm using to try to get the truth out about climate. For 4 years now, operating either independently or through the SSRC, I have been putting out press releases. If you go to the website, and it's on my business card in the back, spaceandscience.net, you will find a record of 4 years of effort to communicate the truth about climate change. This book, however, tries to encapsulate everything. It is written so everyone can understand it, and it has been acclaimed by scientists around the world. I am deeply humbled and honored with some of the comments shown here. These are scientists who spent 30, 40, and sometimes 50 years being the best in their fields, and they think this is a book that everyone needs to read. If you only buy one book, please tell all your friends about it. I'm more concerned that the message get out, not that a lot of books get sold. It's the message that's important. By the way, the last comment, this is an earth-shattering book. That particular comment came from Dr. Dong Choi in Australia. He's the editor-in-chief of the Global Tectonics newsletter. Now, if anyone knows what's earth-shattering, the editor-in-chief of the Global Tectonics newsletter would. So I'm very proud of that comment. So how did we get into this mess in the first place? Why is climate change, why is the environment being used as a tool to hammer every one of us into submission, to pay taxes, to give up our property rights, to do things that are not in our Constitution? Actually, it's fairly straightforward. On the surface, it looks like it's normal business at the UN and our government, but it's insidious business. It is devious business, and it's up to no good. The use of climate and the environment has really had its start many years ago with the greenhouse effect. Svante Arrhenius came up with this idea, and it has hung around for 120 years. Svante Arrhenius, by the way, was essential in the original creation of the Nobel Peace Prize, or Nobel Prize Committee. And guess who got one of the first Nobel Prizes? He did. So it's nice to run a committee or be a part of one and give yourself the Nobel Prize. We should all have our own Nobel Prize committees and give ourselves a Nobel Prize, shouldn't we? At least for standing up to this nonsense, we should get a Nobel Prize, right? But still, this greenhouse idea, people have picked up on that and used it and abused it. Even in his time, greenhouse effect was thoroughly discredited. So it kind of languished, but he kept pushing it and kept pushing it, and now the modern environmental movement picked up on it and said, wow, we ought to use this. It's a great buzzword. People can understand what we're talking about, even if it isn't the truth. Silent Spring by Rachel Carson. I actually have the book with me back there. Silent Spring was given the credit of creating the modern environmental movement, and it did a great deal. If you'll recall, it talked about the overuse of DDT and related chemicals and how much damage that could do. There's a lot of good things that came out of the environmental movement, a lot of good. I am a conservationist. I'm a birder. I mean, if you read my book, you'll see where I talk about when I get my Indiana Jones fedora on and my Roger Torrey Peterson bird book and my big heavy binoculars, and I go out and I look for birds. I love that stuff. I want to see more birds, not less birds. But I don't want to see any birds from the UN, okay? None of those birds. I want to see natural stuff.